So here we have the will of Martha Washington. It was brought to the Fairfax Courthouse to be probated in 1802 after her death. It is 5 pages front and back, and it deals primarily with the distribution of her household items to her grandchildren and other family members. I'm gonna pull out page 1 for you. Now, one thing that is different to Martha's will as opposed to George is that Martha did not write this document herself. I don't know if it's because she was infirm or just unable to write everything. She dictated the document to her granddaughter, Nellie Park Custis Lewis. So this is not Martha's handwriting, this is her granddaughter's, but Martha, much like her husband George, did sign every page of her will. This is a much larger piece of paper than George Washington wrote on. I don't think there's any reason for it other than this is what maybe either Martha or Nellie had on hand. This page was filed with the will of Martha Washington. It actually does not include any of her handwriting or her granddaughter's. Over here, it starts at a court held for Fairfax County the 21st day of June, 1802. And this is where the document was brought to court by the executors of the estate to be filed. This is the identification for the document, the will of Martha Washington. This would have been filed in such a way you can kind of see the folds along both edges. When the clerk filed the document, they would actually fold it so that all you would see is this piece right here sticking up out of a file box. And what this says, it's recorded in Book J at page 133, which is where the court copy of the will was recorded.
Well, the first thing that's clear about Martha Washington's will, it's a great deal shorter than George Washington's will. It runs 5 pages. They're on larger manuscript pages, but it doesn't nearly have the level of detail that George's goes into. She completes the will and on the 22nd day of September in the year 1800, so she prepares this will a little bit less than a year after her husband dies, actually approximately 9 months. Martha's handwriting is on this only in her signature, which is on every page, and in a codicil that she adds on March 4, 1802, in which she designates her mulatto man, Elish, to go to George Washington Park Custis, her grandson, who is a significant beneficiary of this will, as he was of George Washington's will, as likewise. The important thing is that Martha had lifetime beneficiary in George's will. So as long as she was alive, the main assets of the estate, the dividends paid on stock, the rents and earnings from the lands came to her. But she did not have those properties to distribute. Upon her death, the clauses and the directives in Washington's will distributed those lands and those assets. So most of what she has to distribute is property she inherited through the Custis family from her first marriage to Daniel Park Custis, her personal property, wine, plate, pieces of furniture, things of that sort. And that's what takes up most of the pages here, the specifics of who gets what looking glass or who gets what piece of furniture. The really interesting things here, though, when I read through this recently, were two. One is the great pain she takes to take care of her Dandridge relatives. She was the oldest of the Dandridge children, but the longest lived. And she obviously felt great concern that her nieces had money for dowries. And so a large portion of this will sets aside $500 each so they have dowries that would allow them to marry at a proper station. She leaves other monies to nieces and nephews, particularly nephews, to promote their education, and that they are given appropriate opportunities to be trained and have opportunity to have professions or skills or trades. So she is very conscientious about her Dandridge family background, and they were not forgotten. And then one thing tucked in here, which working as I do on George Washington on a daily basis and reading extensively, you get the idea that George and Martha really became partners in their marriage. And the fact that Martha had an earlier marriage, by whom she had 4 children, 2 of whom survived infancy or early childhood, to Daniel Park Custis, largely is forgotten. So the sense is that he, Daniel Park Custis, melted out of her life. I read this will, and one of the clauses is to leave a chest left by Daniel Parke Custis to George Washington Parke Custis. And the sense is this chest had documents and mementos. So she obviously had kept this for decades since his death in the 1750s, prior to her marriage to George, retained it and made certain that it went on within the line of the Custis, so his memory was not forgotten. But it shows that Martha had not entirely forgotten about that first marriage. The beauty of wills is they bring to light information that just doesn't come out elsewhere in the documentary record and gives us things to ponder and things to try to make sense of as we try to understand these people, and particularly their thoughts and feelings, which are the hardest things for historians or people many centuries later to comprehend.
Click the subscribe button below and the bell icon to get notifications for new videos about George Washington and behind-the-scenes work at Mount Vernon.